Hey everyone, welcome to Architecture for Thought. Today we're going to take a quick look at image to 3D. Yes, it exists. It's amazing how quick these AI tools are developing, and I do believe they have a place in the architectural discipline, especially in early concept phase designs where we may be able to 3D print these digital meshes, but also potentially for final production, full-scale architectural 3D prints. We're going to focus on a program called Zoe Depth on the Hugging Face website, then jump into some research called Symmetry-Driven 3D Reconstruction, and lastly, we'll take a sneak peek at a one-stop shop AI-driven 3D software called 3D Guru. Let's jump right in. So per usual, I will leave a link in the video description to all of these websites, but we will start with the Zoe Depth on the Hugging Face. And when you come here, you will see three tabs: Depth Prediction, Image to 3D, and 360 Panorama. We're going to focus on these last two tabs today, and I've got three examples that I want to show. We're going to do three different scales: an architectural sized scale building, a architectural detail, and then the 360 panorama. So let's start with the building, which this image was generated in Midjourney. So an AI generated image. You'll click submit after you upload it, and I have the keep occlusion edges unselected, and that is the edges that basically connect the very distinct foreground from background will not include geometry. So you can see in this model off to the right hand side here that there's no geometry connecting the background to the actual model. This is looking pretty good in this little image viewer here, but let's download the model and take a look at what it looks like in a 3D program. So this is looking pretty great. We've got a lot of depth on this geometry, and you can see the mesh is fairly accurate to the image. I can definitely imagine some programs in the future, AI driven, giving us the capability to basically rotate these images based on the depth maps and in these meshes, and then further being able to prompt, from this perspective to continue basically the geometry or the style of architecture over on the backside here to complete the model. You can imagine even something like Dali's in painting, being able to erase and kind of regenerate parts of the model. But I'm going to rotate the sun here so you can see, you know, how much shadowing and depth there actually is on this geometry. And this is pretty impressive already to even have a model to this level of geometry. And again, this is a digital mesh that we can 3D print if it were closed on the backside. So even if you brought this into Blender or some other kind of sculpting program, and you did include the occlusion edges, which would connect the foreground to the background, you may be able to pinch part of it off and actually 3D print this as a relief model. So very interesting. I'd be interested to see how you guys are planning to use this tool in some of your own research. But let's jump back into our next example. So next we are going to load in a architectural detail, and this is for a 3D printed chair. It's a node or a connector, and I have the actual model of this, so I was interested to see how accurate this program would generate it, and it's looking pretty good. Let's download this and take a look at the model in our 3D program. So this is looking pretty great. I'm going to rotate the model here so you can see the geometry, and it did a pretty good job of accurately portraying the geometry from the image. I'm familiar with what this node actually looks like, and it's got the curvature. It even looks like it's got some of the smooth versus some of the hard edges, pretty accurate. So again, even with a model like this, you know, being able to use a program like this in conjunction with the ability to upload another image or being able to text prompt to generate more image for content aware 3D geometry production, you can imagine being able to complete this model and then exporting it as an STL and being able to 3D print it as a prototype or as a final production model for actual use in product design or architecture. So this is looking really great. Let's jump into our next example. Okay, so last but not least, we're gonna click on the 360 panorama to 3D tab, And it gives you a little disclaimer there, basically saying that it's not trained to produce images or 3D depth maps based on spherical data, but we're going to take a look at what we can do with the data that it produces. So for this one, I'm going to actually keep the occlusion edges on, and I'll show you why in a second. It'll produce basically what looks like this little bubble here, and it's a little strange. It kind of flips it on its side. So once you export it, you may have to rotate it flat, and I'll show you that in a second. But before we jump into that model, I want to show you the actual 3D virtual reality image, which is right here. We'll do full screen. And you can see, you know, these are very high quality images, but the point I wanted to make is that it's only from one perspective, and we're basically aligned with this edge of this wall here and the wine cooler, and on center with basically the range and the island, and as I rotate around, the fireplace on the other side. So let's jump into the 3D model, and we'll take a look at how we can actually rotate or move ourselves through the space to gain some additional perspectives. Alright, so I've loaded this into my 3D builder, and I've rotated it flat. And you can see, again, it's just basically a bubble from the exterior. It's wrapped in the panoramic image. But let's jump into this bubble and see what we can see. So now I'm on the inside, and when I was describing before, basically that the panoramic image that we saw on our company's website, we were aligned with basically this wall and the wine cooler, and when we rotate on center with this range, this basically, because it's a 3D model, gives us the ability to actually shift out of center with that. And because we kept the occlusion edges on, surfaces that are distinctly broken, for instance, such as the island, it actually keeps that geometry as a surface, cutting all the way back to the next depth plane that it has. So this is really amazing. I mean, it's producing basically the 3D model from that panoramic image. And even over here, if you can see the edge of the island, you know, you're seeing it move in front and behind, basically, you know, the spaces around it. So this is really amazing. I mean, it gives you a little more freedom in the space, basically, to explore panoramic images from a panoramic image that you already have made. And again, you can imagine how you can start to link some of these images, or be able to come in here and text prompt over parts of this image, or you know, connect some of these bubbles together to get actual 3D models with interpolated geometry between them. So this is an amazing tool. Another kind of great advancement in the AI image to 3D models that we've got going on here. Very curious to see what you guys are able to come up with using some of these technologies. All right, next I wanted to take a quick look at this research called Symmetry-Driven 3D Reconstruction from Concept Sketches. And I'll leave a link in the description to this PDF if you want to look through it. But about halfway down, it gives some examples about how they're using the symmetry based on these concept drawings to produce 3D models. And they actually released a video with some examples of it that I'll play a clip from here. And it shows the sketch in the top left corner, and then the reproduction of that sketch in 3D based upon an axis, basically. And there's a couple variations of it, but we can definitely see how a program like this, mixed with the depth map and the digital meshes that we're just looking at in some of the other programs, can be combined to give you the capability to actually edit the 3D model with sketch lines. So this is another research program called Sketch to Mesh, and it's reconstructing and editing 3D shapes from sketches. But then it looks like actually gives you the ability to redraw. For instance, it's showing a line being drawn on the top here, and then adapting that 3D generated model to fit that new line. And so they give a couple examples of that here. I wanted to show this because I think it's pretty interesting to imagine basically that you will be able to create these 3D models, rotate them, and draw and adjust the model based on your scribbles or sketches or text prompts to complete the models or just refine them based on how you want them. And then you basically have a 3D print ready model to work from. So last but not least, as I mentioned at the beginning of this video, I had a conversation with the developer of this program, which is called 3D Guru, a very interesting program, and there's a video of it on their website here that basically shows you can text prompt the size of a room. It makes a room for you in 3D. You can text prompt furniture pieces and it will create those furniture pieces in the space. You can text prompt images or textures to apply to the wall, ceiling, floor, etc., and use those as inspiration or reference images for then text prompting an image in the same program. So this is all in one, basically a one-stop shop where you can do all of these things. And he showed me a tutorial. They gave me access to it. I'm not going to do that in this video. We'll do another video where I kind of go through that in more depth. But it's really interesting to see that we're starting to get 3D programs now, not just these Hugging Face websites or anything like that, where we have these capabilities, AI capabilities, in the 3D programs to give us the ability to render, produce content, models, place the models, generate room sizes, different types of rooms, just based on text prompts. So I wanted to give you guys a glimpse at this because I've seen a couple other programs as well starting to do similar things. One was called Spline, and I'm signing up for all these wait lists basically to try and get in so I can show you guys what these things look like in real time. And I do realize these technologies are in their very early stages, and what I'm presenting here is very experimental. If you're still in school or just out of school and just learning the traditional workflows of architecture and the architectural process, I still encourage you to do that because it's important to understand the difference in the way things work now and will continue to work for probably the next 5 to 10 years or even beyond that before we start to transition to using these tools primarily in the office. The more I work with these tools, the more I'm starting to see programs like Revit start to feel like AutoCAD because they are so progressive, and when combined with the ability to control parameters and edit in 3D based on text prompts and just quick generative designs and variations, you can see how quickly we'll be able to jump to a point where architecture does become more raster based, meaning image based, rather than these precise vector line drawings that we've been doing for a very long time. That is representation, and this is presentation of the actual content that will be immediately 3D printed or digitally fabricated. So again, I understand these are very experimental workflows, and I want to encourage you to still pursue the traditional workflows so that you can understand, if you are attempting to implement any of these technologies, what the differences are and why you would do that in one scenario versus another scenario. So that's going to be it for now. I did want to mention I had the opportunity to be interviewed by Dmitry Ponchnikov, who has a YouTube channel called the UH Studio Design Academy. He does amazing Blender tutorials and has a great outlook on architecture in general. So I'll leave a link to his page in my description. You should go over there and follow him, so when the podcast does come out, you'll be able to watch it. We had a great conversation basically about what I was just mentioning, the importance of knowing the traditional workflows and still 3D modeling, digital geometry, and where the transition might start to occur with the implementation of AI and architecture. So thanks again for coming by, and we'll see you next time.